right, we will go ahead and get started with our second part here. And this part is a fellowship panel and hopefully is going to be driven by you guys with questions you have about fellowship. So we have three fellowship directors up here. So I'm just going to ask them to introduce themselves and where they are and what their specialties are. And then if you guys have questions, if you just go up to one of the mics and ask questions, if you don't have questions, I have some questions, and we'll get the ball rolling. All right, so.
Sure. Thanks, Darcy. I'm Jared Christensen. I'm Division Chief of Cardiothoracic Radiology at Duke University. I've been Fellowship Director for 6 years, but I guess by way of disclosure, I'm releasing myself of those responsibilities as I'm starting an MBA program. But I have lots of experience with fellowships, so welcome your questions.
Hi, I'm Avis O'Connell. I'm Fellowship Director of Breast Imaging at the University of Rochester. And so I'm Fellowship Director and Director of Breast Imaging, so it's all rolled in one. And we'd like you to ask a lot of questions. And one of the questions you should be asking is, how do you pick the right fellowship for you, and if you're going into private practice or academic practice? Because that's one of the biggest things. Like, there's a slightly, you know, you want to know everything, of course, but you do want to have a different slant or have some fellowship that's flexible enough to have you do what you need for where you plan to go. I mean, if you know you're going to go back home to Wisconsin or Utah or whatever, you might know the need there. And but if you're going to work up the academic ladder, that's a slightly different need. So we're hoping you have. So if you don't have questions, we have primed a few that we think you should be asking. So.
Hey, I'm Tara Khan. I'm Program Director of Emergency Radiology at Emory University and Associate Director of the Division of Emergency and Trauma Imaging down there as well.
All right. So does anyone have questions? If you could go up to the mic, they're recording it so it gets the audio better. Thanks.
So one of the lectures that was given to us by one of the chairs from UCSD was excellent in terms of, he said that we should sort of really squeeze as much as we can out of contacts and, you know, friends of friends. But let's say you're going somewhere and, you know, you want to get sort of the dirt on certain places, you know, to allow you to make the best decision. But if you don't have any contacts there, what do you do? How do you find out?
You talk to the residents. They'll always dish out. Not the staff. The faculty won't. No, I mean, you go and spend some time there, and you ask to talk to the residents or last year's fellow. You have to. They won't ever mind telling you things because they are leaving. And if you ask the faculty, they'll always tell you the sanitized version, I would say. What do you think?
I'll add to that. You know, I've actually voluntarily will give our fellow interview candidates the names of several previous fellows, their emails, email them, ask them questions. They often won't even know who you are. They won't know why you're emailing them. Introduce yourself. You know, they have no reason to lie to you about the program. I think interviewing or meeting at least current residents or current fellows during interview is a great idea. If you can do it in a casual or social setting, if there is some sort of lunch or dinner in a fellowship interview, gives you a great opportunity to see what's going on at the program.
I agree.
Yeah, I'll kind of echo what I am not the fellowship. I'm an abdominal imager. I am not the fellowship director I was. But I will say that reaching out to people, you know, it's not something that's in my nature. I'm much more introverted than extroverted. So the thought of emailing somebody I met at a conference once or that sort of thing is not normally in my wheelhouse. But when I forced myself to do it, it is amazing how generous our profession is. I've never had anyone be like, who are you or what is this? People are incredibly gracious and people will tell you whatever you want to know, especially, you know, former fellows and that sort of thing. Those are the people to reach out to. And I know it can feel a little awkward, and this applies on multiple different levels, you know, but really don't hesitate to reach out to people, because even people you think that are, you know, much more advanced in their career and like, why would they respond to this email? I've had incredibly positive experiences, so don't hesitate to do that. If they give you their contact information, they're expecting you to reach out.
You might also, to ease in, because you want to know the good and the bad, so you might say, could you tell me the three best things and maybe the three worst things about being in Rochester, New York? The weather will be at the top of the bad things. But, you know, things like that, you know, who's, you know, did they give you enough time to study? Did they give you protected time? One of the big questions, is there an academic day? I mean, mm-hmm. you need to make a list of what's important, because if you're going to go into academic practice, you want to have, you know, posters and projects and maybe get your name on a couple of papers and make contacts, too. So you want to know protected time, you want to know conference time, you want to know professional allowance. But, I mean, I think if you ask the three best, so some things are the same across all the places you would interview. So I think if you have the same 10 questions, and some impecunious residents need to know, can they moonlight? That's just about all residents. Can they moonlight? And moonlighting sometimes, even if you don't, it's sometimes just babysitting the contrast in the office after hours, in one of the offices. So, I mean, you know, you need to have a list of questions. What are your priorities? And you need to get over being an introvert, because it is a year of your life, and if you're miserable, your whole family is going to be miserable. So it's worth getting the questions out there.
I'll just kind of, from our perspective, most of the time the fellow applicants that we receive, they're applying to what I would consider to be peer equivalent programs, and they could go to any of those places and they're going to receive excellent training in cardiothoracic imaging, both cardiac and pulmonary. And so it often comes down to other more intangibles. And for me as a fellowship director, it's always one of these things, well, what is it going to take to perhaps get this person here, or of all these applicants that we've had, maybe who has a tie or possible tie to Durham? Because quite honestly, between Duke and Mass General or UCSF, I think the training is equivalent, although I should probably say we're better. but then it comes down to is like, well, why would someone come to Durham, North Carolina instead of like Boston or San Francisco? And so we during our interview process, we actually will ask some of those questions. We'd like to know where else they're applying, why they're interested in Duke specifically. Not that it should play any, not that it should make any difference, but certainly if someone has a tie to the Triangle area, either they were there as an undergrad or they have family in the area, we certainly take that into consideration, at least in our program, because Durham's hard to compete with, again, those big cities, so.
Yeah. Any paper publications make any difference in a fellowship application? Because I'm from a small program, we don't have that much data to have a paper publication. So we usually have posters and that kind of educational exhibit. So.
Sure.
Generally, the answer is no. I mean, if you know, what we look for is a demonstrated interest in the subspecialty. So, you know, if you have somehow in your residency demonstrated that you want, I'll speak for emergency radiology, demonstrated you want to go into emergency radiology, you have some abstract submitted around that. I think the issue of papers or publishing a good bit is much more important. If you're going to a fellowship program and saying, hey, I want to do academics, I'm interested in coming to your program, do you have academic days, do you have research? At that level, maybe it would be more important to demonstrate why you're so interested in academic, to kind of fit that as a piece of the puzzle into your fellowship application. But I think in terms of just generally applying for fellowship spots, no one's going to turn you down for a fellowship on the basis of not having a publication as a resident.
So I may have a slightly different take. Even though most of our fellows still go into private practice, the majority who are applying have some sort of demonstrated scholarly activity. So most of our applicants have either published or certainly have several presentations, but it's highly variable. I mean, we've had applicants who have like 15 publications already and others who have none or one. And so it's not the only factor we look at, but for me, it doesn't matter what their academic activity has been in. We've had people who have done projects in neuro or MSK or whatever. And so I think the notion that you have to already have done some research in your selected subspecialty, at least for our program, doesn't apply. What is important is we like to see that someone is curious from an academic standpoint, that they've engaged in some sort of scholarly activity. And again, some people, they know they want to go into academics. Others want to go into private practice. And so sometimes that's made clear ahead of time, but it's not going to exclude you one way or the other. But if you do have some scholarly activity, it's certainly not going to hurt. It's something that we do look for in our fellowships. And again, just not, doesn't matter what it's in, but basically just so that you have an understanding of kind of the scientific process and what an IRB is and how to form a hypothesis, things of that nature. So,
yeah, I would agree with all that. And the interest and to do so and the lack of opportunity can easily show if you're in a small program, you're clearly not going to be able to be second or third author on some massive paper. So, you know, that's all part of the interview and the discussion. So I think that so long as everybody's on the same page and a willingness to participate. Now, of course, you're also an example to the residents too, as well. So because often the fellow will have one or two residents on each assignment. So, I mean, you have to understand that if they're interested in doing things, you'll be interested in leading them and, you know, getting involved as well. So I think a lot of it is just willingness and expressing where you stand and where you're trying to go. Because nowhere, I mean, I hadn't really thought about, well, ED has to be somewhere with an emergency, but breast is one where clearly people have two tracks. One is private practice, one is academic practice. No, there's more, then there's three. There's a track where your perfect job, our chairman gave this example, he was in Brown and his perfect job came up in IR of all things, but he had to do one day of mammo. Maybe one day a month, maybe one day a week, he got cold sweats and nightmares. He said, I couldn't take that job. It was my dream job. So, I mean, if you're honest about it, and some the other question you need to ask is some breast fellowships are only 6 months. So if you can find a place that does 6 months, if you're going to general practice, then 6 months of breast and then 6 months of either abdomen or MSK or something else is wonderful, or neuro. But I think, so there's so many options out there. So you have to, you're very clear what you want, so you have to let us know what it is you want and see if it can fit the mold. Some people have more than one fellow, in which case one can be going one track and one another. Some places have two fellows. We offer everything from two fellows alternating the 6 months, the breast and abdomen, and then they switch over and do abdomen and breast. So all of this is available. There's a lot of flexibility, certainly in the breast fellowships. But 6 months is the minimum. 12 months if you're going to do breast only is ideal, but if you're going to practice, you might like to have a little of both. So you don't have to give up that perfect job because you couldn't read a mammogram.
Question?
How would you rank the four most important things that you look for in an application? And then part two is, what kind of letters of recommendation should people be getting?
Who wants to start?
We'll start with what you look for in an applicant.
All right.
And then so, we'll come back to part two.
Thinking off the top of my head here. So so obviously there's two parts to the fellowship application. There's or the application itself, how you look on paper, and then from those we identify who we're going to invite to interview, and then there's the interview process. And I'll kind of handle those separately. So on paper, we do look at, I guess, academic proficiency, and that can be based on, at least at our program, we request USMLE scores. We also take into consideration where you performed your residency. The personal statement, although I think people maybe don't pay as much attention to it, at least for me as a fellowship director, it was important because it's really the first time I get a look at what your personality is like, what your insights are into a career in radiology, whether it's academic or private practice. And the letters of recommendation I also think are important. I want to hear from your current residency program director and kind of where you fit within your residency. your leadership potential, things of that nature. And then from someone in the field, so hopefully if you're going into cardiothoracic, you know someone who can write you a letter who's a cardiothoracic radiologist. But it's certainly important that the authors of your letters know you well and can speak to your strengths. And I don't know if that's any particular given order since we take everything as a whole, but that's kind of where I would stand on those.
Certainly on paper is good, but I don't trust paper. And that would be very important. So when you come for the interview, if there's a discrepancy, that'll be a really bad thing. So it's better to be honest in paper because you can make yourself look great on paper, but make sure you can back up everything you say you do. We recently had an anonymous survey so that we could work out what people did on their academic day. And there were 20 people who said they were first authors on a paper in the last year. And you can guess who. My son checked it out thinking, that's a lot of first authors. There were six. So let me just say, be honest. Be honest, be truthful. Don't promise something you're not. And so, I think, you need a decent application on paper, but I think when you come for the interview, that's where you really get a feel for whether you're a fit for that location. So I would just add that. Be honest.
I'll echo what was said. There's some things you can't change, right? You can't change where you're going to residency. You can affect your performance during residency while you're there. But if you're looking at the time of application, letters of recommendation are very important. To me personally, it doesn't matter if it comes from a nationally renowned radiologist, if they don't know you. It doesn't have to come from your chair. I do look to see if there is a letter of recommendation from the program director. If there's not, you do wonder why there's not. There are programs that are so large that, the program director may just write a form letter, or perhaps you've never worked with the program director personally and it's just gonna be a conglomeration of your other recommendations from other faculty. I think that's fine. That's something I may mention when I'm talking to the program director of the fellowship. But letters of recommendation and personal statement. I think personal statement, some of what we talked about where you can telegraph what your career are, where you can put together all the components of your application. So let's say you've done a ton of publication. You can say in your personal statement, my goal is to be an academic mammographer at a large breast center doing only interventions. And that's why I'm targeting your fellowship, because you guys do a lot of interventions. That is important to us in emergency radiology. Emergency radiology is still the smallest of the radiology subspecialties. There's not a lot of fellowships. So if someone has a demonstrated interest in that, that holds a lot of weight, and they can telegraph that in their personal statement.
So now I'd like to speak briefly on the interview part.
I was going to say, that keeps coming up.
Could we get a show of hands of which fellowships in the room people are
interested in? I'll start with my own then. So anyone interested in abdominal imaging? Smattering, yes, okay. Chest? Couple?
Not
breast? Oh. Emergency? Trauma? Neuro radiology? Oh, a whole bunch of neuro. IR?
Yeah. How about musculoskeletal?
Oh, yeah, MSK?
Peds.
Wow, still popular. Peds? A couple peds out there? All right.
Cool. Quite a good
mix.
Yeah. Very good mix. All right.
Well, so once...
Yeah, definitely touch on the interview because it kind of keeps coming up.
So once we review the paper applications, and again, from my perspective, there's not one single element that is most important, we'll kind of identify who we're going to invite to interview. And as Avis had kind of mentioned, this is really our opportunity to get to know you and find out if we want to work with you for the next year. And a lot of it has to do with personality. So from our perspective, once you are invited to interview, the paper application is kind of goes away, and then it becomes all about the interview. I will say, don't try too hard. Just be yourself. Come prepared with some questions. Even if you already know the answers, you never know what kind of answers you'll get. Ask similar questions to your interviewers. And from there, again, with the residents, we only work with them not as frequently. I also interview for our residency program, but with the fellows, you're essentially working with them day in and day out, and so you want to make sure that it's going to be a good fit for the program. And I know that's kind of an oblique term, a good fit. For me, it comes down to a little bit about personality. It comes down to what I could glean from the questions as far as personal interest and work ethic. It's one of those intangibles that you just kind of get a feel like, gosh, yeah, I wouldn't mind seeing this person every day and reading out together. So, others?
Mm-hmm. Then there's also the question, as a woman in a practice that has a lot of young women applying, because breast imaging does tend to be, the question nobody can ask you is, are you planning to have babies during your fellowship? And if so, how much time off gets you the fellowship? And in residency, you've the 12 weeks for breast, and if there's anything less, you have to make it up. But it's something, I don't know whether you'd feel like coming straight out and saying, but you can't, really, and we can't ask you. And it's a very difficult situation for when it comes up, if you have two equal candidates and there's just one spot, then and you really depend on your fellow. You know, these, I don't have an answer to this, and we would certainly not, because actually almost every, in fact, one of our best fellows ever had just come off maternity leave when she started her fellowship. She, by accident, got pregnant again during her fellowship because, you know, she just did. It happens. And she was one of our best, and we hired her afterwards. So I'm just saying it's kind of one of those things that you might wonder, people might say obliquely, oh, are you married yet? And oh, you just got married, you know what I mean? Because as somebody staffing a department, you need to know if you really need that resident to do tumor board every Monday, and that fellow. So anyway, these are questions we can't ask you, but you can imagine we're thinking about them, so I don't know. I don't know if that helps you at all. It doesn't. In most cases, though, if you're a really good candidate, because we've hired back several of our fellows. So in our case, it's a short, that would not be a problem. But I think you have to be aware that, you know, you don't want to be hiding the fact that you're already 3 months pregnant when you okay. Oh, no, you do your fellowship match 2 years before, so it's okay.
Yeah. I'm just going to jump on a last comment that was made. You know, in terms of looking to hire fellows, we also do a lot of hiring of our own fellows, so do a lot of the programs in our area. We get a lot of calls from local private practice groups about hiring. If you know where you want to end up for whatever reason, your family is there, doing a fellowship in or near the city or geographic location where you want to have a career helps a lot. Because, you know, Emory University is the only radiology program in Atlanta, so all the private practice groups in Atlanta, in the greater Georgia area, will call and asking about whatever subspecialty they need. So just a plug, if you have a specific geographic area, consider that when you're looking at fellowship options. Okay.
More questions?
More questions? Anyone? Yeah.
So I guess kind of tying on that theme about kind of staying at the same institution, let's say in terms of, you know, and imagining equivalency, the benefits of staying at the institution you trained at to do fellowship versus benefits to going somewhere else, you know, for your fellowship. Let's say, just kind of the pros and cons of that.
Sure. Well, I'll start off.
That's a great question.
So I think most programs kind of think they do an excellent job training. And so the fact that, hey, we've trained this person, we know they're well trained, is important. We certainly also kind of view the fellowship as a year-long interview process. Sometimes we might have a spot that we know is going to be open and we'll be looking, and that's in the back of our mind. But I will say the I guess, converse would be, so at least at Duke, we're required to post all job openings, and we have to advertise and interview, preferably not just internal applicants, but also outside applicants, which I think is sometimes nerve-wracking for the internal candidates, because they think, oh, maybe I'm not good enough. They're looking at other people, and there certainly can be this kind of like starstruck, oh, we've got some person applying from some other program. But I personally like hiring our former fellows because they know us. We already know if it's going to be a good fit or not. I also tend to be pretty direct with our fellows. So we give formal feedback every 3 months to our fellows. And certainly if we're looking for to fill a position, I let them know early on whether or not I think they'll be a competitive applicant. I've never told someone not to apply, but most of the time, like, we want them to apply, and they're kind of favored in that aspect. But I do agree, if you think you might be interested in a specific geographic area, I do think it's helpful to train at that area. And even with places like, I have friends and colleagues at Mass General, they'll say like, oh yeah, sometimes we want to get talent from somewhere else, but more often than not, they're hiring internally or former fellows. So.
Can I just give you the exact opposite of that. So if you fast forward 15 or 20 years, we're just having that situation. When you're hiring for very high levels like vice chairs and chairs, if you have an applicant who has never been anywhere out of your town, now if it's Boston, I suppose, you know, but I mean, if it's the same institution all the way up, you sometimes feel that that person didn't have that's that broader view. So if you've done medical school and residency and fellowship, and then you take a job there, now I'm not saying it would disqualify you, but sometimes we wonder, you know, wouldn't it be nice to have that person at least have some other life experience? But once you get locked in and your children are in school, I mean, it gets really hard to pull up the whole family just to go away for a year. So I mean, these are not easy situations, but it can work both ways, is really what I'm saying.
I guess one other thing I'd say is, so in our division, we have lots of people who are doing procedures, who are doing cardiac, who are doing vascular MR, we've got all the bases covered, and every once in a while, we'll be looking specifically for maybe someone who can fill a particular niche. So if that's the case, I mean, you can't predict that moving forward. So the one thing I would say is I would just look at fellowship programs where you're going to get comprehensive training so that you can be prepared for any opportunity that comes along.
Yeah, and I was basically going to say that to some extent the answer is it depends. Let's say you know that you want to go to a group, or you have some idea what you want to do, or you have a strong interest in prostatic MRI, right? You may then target a fellowship that does a lot of that if that was lacking in your residency. So some of it depends on what your residency is. Is it a small residency? Is it at a quaternary care center? And what type of practice you want to have, whether it's academic or private?
Yeah, I think the bottom line is that there are definitely pros and cons. When I was looking at fellowships, I got advice on both sides. Some people said, don't stay where you did your residency because it gives you a different perspective and you already know their strengths and weaknesses. And some people said, well, you should stay because you know exactly what you're getting into. I ended up leaving, but I know people who stayed. And so, you know, it depends on a lot of factors. And the geography is something that I just want to echo because it's something that I don't think residents think about when they're picking a fellowship. If you really are, you know, your family's in an area, your spouse is in an area, and you want to be near the grandparents or whatever, I would urge you to really consider doing your fellowship there because it kind of ties into all the things that we were talking about in the first session about networking and meeting people. You know, in Atlanta, if you want to be in Atlanta, try to go to Emory because they know that group and you'll be able to network more. It's much harder to move around, especially private practice. Academic people, we kind of know each other, but private practice groups really tend to know the people in the area, so you'll get to know people and network with that. Other questions? Yeah.
Let's say you go somewhere and then, you know, family's in a different city. It sounds like it sounds like you're hurting yourself if you don't make it work in that city, even if your passion may be with another program where it works.
Not necessarily. Again, there's two sides, to, right? It kind of goes back to what I talked about earlier. It's what's important to you, you know? The best advice I ever got about looking for a job was Ahab Kamel at Hopkins. That's where I did my fellowship. When we were looking for jobs, he said, you need to sit down and write down what is important to, for you in a job. You know, we were abdominal imagers, so was doing mammo, like no mammo, was that at the top of the list or was that further down? Was geography, was salary, was, you know, all these different things. Only you know how that order goes, and then you try to find the job that fits it closest, right? If someone who their main motivation is money, they'll work in East Texas doing general radiology and doing whatever, living there, because that was their motivator. For other people, that's just not going to work because that's not their main motivator. So it's kind of on the same level, right? You have to figure out what works for you. If geography is really, really important, give that some thought. If that's a little less important, then, you know, broaden it out. It's just one more thing to consider.
Now, I'll echo that with a specific example. You know, when I say that the groups in Atlanta target Emory, let's say the hiring partner for the largest private practice group in Atlanta is Amy, she'll call all of the program directors, the fellowship program directors at Emory, when they're ready to hire, whatever it is that, you know, they hire multiple radiologists a year. That doesn't mean that people from other cities or other institutions never get jobs, but Amy has those names and gets them first, and they also are receiving applications. They post their jobs mm-hmm. like almost everyone else on the ACR. So you can still get your foot in the door. It just gives you a little bit of a leg up just because the connection is so much tighter.
An academic position in a place that's different from where you did your fellowship or residency. For example, can I go to California if I've done my residency and fellowship on the East Coast?
Well, let me start with that. The story used to be anybody west of Chicago would never, they may come and interview with us, and we always said they're just practicing. Because if you come from the West Coast, you might be just practicing. And if all else fails, they'll turn up where you are. But it used to be that no matter how much you liked the person, if they came from California, they were not going to come to Rochester, New York, because the weather and everything else, you know. But so I think if you're a good applicant, but you have to be very persuasive. If you came to me from California, I would wonder why. Now, here's a question. What's wrong with you? Here's a question. No, but now, here's the other thing. How about the dual career, the dual fellowship? How many people here will be looking to match a fellowship with a spouse? You know, because that's now becoming a huge thing. I mean, will your program guarantee a GI fellowship and a breast fellowship or an MSK or whatever? And if not, do you have a place for, because we have several fellows whose husbands are doing hospitalist years. They've had to give up a year, get one fellowship and then follow by the, this is something that more couples have to decide. It'd be ideal if you can get the two fellowships at the same time, but that's another question in your search for the perfect place. Is there a place for your spouse to either do private practice for a year, waiting for you, or both of you at the same time? I mean, that's something that I don't know if we even advertise dual fellowships. It could be a selling point, I suppose, if you were desperate to get people to upstate New York, for example.
I think some of the answer to that question depends on your subspecialty. So certain small subspecialties where a practice, say, of pediatric radiologist or cardiothoracic imagers, especially if you have any geographic restrictions, may only have an opening once every 2 or 3 years, then it may be more worthwhile to start targeting that area earlier. You know, it so happens, I mean, we were hiring 6 emergency radiologists at Emory this year, so it didn't matter where in the country you were from, we would consider you if you applied. And something like abdominal imaging, there's a lot of very large abdominal imaging groups and academic centers around the country. So to some extent, I think it depends on your subspecialty.
I definitely think it depends on the subspecialty and as well as the job market. At least in cardiothoracic, for years, it was pretty much, you went into cardiothoracic if only you were going to do academics. Every once in a while, we had someone going into private practice. But with cardiac imaging kind of taking more of a role, and certainly lung cancer screening, we've seen an impact where some former fellows in our abdominal division, for example, they want to come back and get some experience or exposure with lung cancer screening, or do some time with cardiac CT or cardiac MR, because now there's more of a demand in private practice for it. But I think the job market, it's unpredictable, it's cyclical, and again, I'd probably fall back on you want to end up at a program where you're going to get perhaps the most comprehensive training, or what's going to be the best compromise for you. But at least in our specialty, again, it's a small world, and so we get asked all the time, like, what do you know about this fellow who trained with you, who has since gone on to another job, and now they're looking at a new job? And so so the fellowship year, even though it's 1 year, you would think residency is maybe more important because it's so much longer, but that fellowship year is going to follow you and weigh, I think, disproportionately large as far as your career is concerned. But yeah, so I'll also just say, personally, I don't know how I ended up at Duke. I considered myself, I started out studying architecture as an undergrad. I only applied to two medical schools. I ended up at the University of Vermont, and which was heavy on primary care. From there, I ended up actually at the University of Rochester for residency after spending some time doing surgery at the University of Virginia, where I was an undergrad. And then it came time to select a specialty, and I liked pretty much everything, but I did find myself drawn to thoracic imaging. And so then it became, well, which fellowship programs? And at that time we had 5 children, and I now have 8 children. And so I'm still, and we're done. But at least for me, like I interviewed at Stanford, at Mass General, at Duke, at Michigan, at kind of all the places, quote unquote, you're supposed to interview when looking at cardiothoracic, and I had offers from those places. But the reality was, is like, I couldn't afford to live in Palo Alto, and I couldn't afford to live in Boston. And so it was essentially Michigan or Duke seemed to be the best kind of options for us. And I was tired of the snow. So Duke was where we ended up. And they didn't have a job when I was a fellow. But it just so happened that for some reason the chair liked me. And they brought me on as kind of an investment. And I guess it paid off. And then short time thereafter, I was asked to be division chief, and so that's where I've kind of built my career, is at Duke. But again, looking at paper, it doesn't seem like I should be there, but it's been a great place. And so, and I will say, we've had fellow applicants from like West Virginia that we've made offers to, and places that maybe you would think like, I mean, why would you take someone from West Virginia over someone from, say, UCSF? And again, there's a lot of different factors that go into play. And also, don't underestimate like the power of an email or a phone call, or even better yet, if someone writes your letter who has ties to that institution. Because at least for me, there are certain letter writers that carry a bit more weight. Because again, we get residents from the same programs year after year, and so I have a long memory, and so I can remember that this person, like say Ella from Michigan, Ella Casaruni, she wrote a fantastic letter about this applicant, but then like the next year is only kind of a little more lukewarm, and so it's a small world, and people who you know can be helpful for what it's worth.
I think in that description, it also shows that you don't have to be too sure where you want to be. and what specialty yet, because you should have been primary care, maybe in private practice, you might have been, you could have been in anything. So, I mean, when the right thing comes up, you'll know. The other thing is, don't ever say, oh, I've just looked at that department. Nobody's going to retire or change there for years, so there's not going to be a job. The one thing that's guaranteed is there'll be a change. Yeah. So even, and some people are willing to hire ahead. It doesn't always work in my department, where you know there's going to be an opening in a couple of years, and you have the perfect person, but you're told you can't offer a job until there's a job, which is a shame, because this is where some places can do that flexibility. But I'm just saying, don't ever assume there'll be no job there because they're all filled, and don't ever assume that you know for sure what specialty you're going to be happiest in, because you might change your mind as you get more exposure.
Yeah, as you talk to people and hear how people ended up in their jobs, it's more and more stories like yours, you know, where it's like, I don't know how I ended up here, because mine is very similar. Any other questions? Yeah.
So I mean, I guess leading off that, I mean, you mentioned that, you know, you kind of ended up in cardiothoracic or body. How should we go about figuring out where we should kind of go for our specialties? Is there a better way or a worse way, I guess, going about that?
Let me start with the Monday morning test. So your assignment just changed, and it's Monday morning, and it's raining or snowing, and are you going to hate the day or wonder how soon you can get through it? I mean, really, it's how, through your residency, you've rotated in all the specialties, and although the personalities will be different from where you go and do your fellowship and where you eventually work, but if you absolutely hate doing mammography, I mean, one of our current, it's not the thing to say to your chief, is like, if it's any consolation to you, Dr. O'Connell, if I make mistakes, I am never, ever going to read a mammogram in my life. I just have to get through the exam. Not the kind of thing to say. And then he goes ahead and makes all kinds of mistakes. So, but anyway, so, you know, you'll know when you hate it and you'll know when you love it. And if you're still not sure, eventually you'll know.
Yeah, personal enjoyment or personal experience and personal enjoyment is the number one reason that residents choose a subspecialty. I think some of the wild card are, depending on your residency, you may not have a lot of exposure to a subspecialty before you're forced to choose. Hopefully, if you're in a program that allows you some flexibility, if you think you may be interested in, say, pediatric radiology, but normally the rotation doesn't occur until late in your second year, you have some flexibility, trade with another resident, talk to your chief residents, where you can get that moved earlier on, because really doing the rotation and then kind of taking a second step, working with faculty, getting some faculty mentors, maybe trying out a research project, getting as much exposure as you can help you learn if it's something that you enjoy enough to do for the rest of your life.
Yeah, I'll definitely echo the mentor comment. So as I mentioned, I was at the University of Vermont as a medical student, and on my radiology elective, Jeff Klein, who many of you probably know, is now the editor of Radiographics, or has been for a few years now. He's a chest radiologist. I got to work with him, and it was just very enjoyable. And I mean, the schedule was great too, but it was one of those things where I'd never really thought about radiology. And that was kind of my first kind of chest exposure. And I kind of ignored that and ended up deciding I thought I wanted to be a surgeon, which I definitely enjoyed doing surgery. And then my wife hated it, and so then I started thinking about, well, what else could I do? And I kind of came back to that, and a lot of it had to do with that kind of first experience. And I've kept in contact with Jeff through the years, and he's been a great mentor. And during residency, I had great experiences. But for better or worse, your perception of a specialty is largely going to be formed by the faculty at your institution. But just remember that they're not the specialty, that it's bigger than any individual. And so a lot of it does have to do with content matter, in addition to the people you get to work with.
I would echo the Monday morning thing, because the advice I got was, take the study that no one else wants to read in that specialty. So like, I'm an abdominal imager. If the thought of reading a DVT study makes you want to gouge your eyes out, you probably shouldn't go into abdominal imaging, right? Like, we read DVT studies. So think about the thing that's kind of the drudgery for that specialty, because chances are, even if you're in a tertiary care quaternary center, you're going to have to do that thing. So, you know, if lung cancer screening makes you want to hurt yourself,
it's
chest
great.
Is probably not for you.
But Jared did mention his wife hated it. So lifestyle and family
yes.
is important. One of my kids thought he was going to be a neurosurgeon. That's Don. Wife. Kind of like, that won't last, it won't make it. You know, you have to understand, because, you know, the old days where the dad went to work and the mom stayed home doesn't happen anymore, thankfully. But, I mean, you do have to, if you want to be an active parent, you have to understand if you're going to do neurointerventional or whatever, you know, you may not be around as much. Now, the other thing is, so I have here lifestyle and what is that. And then the other... I always, you know, when we were going through medical school, you had these personality profiles. The rugby players would go into orthopedics usually. The philosophers went into psychiatry. And so there was a kind of we kind of pretended we had this sort of thing. But the truth is, if you can't stand talking to patients, then you want to go into a specialty. Some radiologists back in the day would go to a dark room and spend all day in front of the view box with a dictaphone and never see a patient. Well, the move now is, of course, everybody should at least interact with patients. But if you actually like interacting with patients, breast imaging is one, and you never cannot. If you like doing procedures, so you have a mixture, if you like if you like screening and doing procedures and meeting your patient, there's one. There's pediatrics, where you're meeting parents and patients. So it depends what kind of person you are. If you really don't want to talk to people, then there's a specialty that might be just that. I don't know what. When would you never talk to your patients? I don't know. But anyway, you have to decide. No, I mean, maybe MSK, I don't know. Maybe.
No, you do, Arthur
no.
Grimes.
But anyway, some have more talking to patients, some has less. Yeah. So you have to think what kind of person you are, because if you're going to be a good radiologist, you better not be, quite apart from the hating Monday mornings, but if you don't want to interact as much with the patient, you may choose something with less hands-on.
I'm going to add a comment about lifestyle. You know, subspecialties have vastly different lifestyles in academics or private practice. Mammographers take less call generally than other specialties. Obviously, I'm in emergency radiology. We do 24/7, 365 coverage. Most emergency radiologists do overnight shift work of some sort. Neuroradiologists, we have a tremendous number of neuroradiologists who join emergency radiology. Neuro is the most common high-volume specialty after hours, especially high-end neuro. So that's something you do want to think about. You know, if you're going into neuroradiology and you think that you're going to work 8 to 5, that's going to be really difficult. If you're going into emergency radiology and you think you're going to work 8 to 5, you'll probably be unemployed. Now, you can take that, and I think like was mentioned in the first hour, if you're doing emergency radiology or neuroradiology, if you're doing after hours or overnight shift work of any sort, usually the schedules are very flexible and they're very desirable. So we do a 7-on, 14-off model for overnight coverage. So if you're doing 2 or 3 weeks of overnights a year, you're getting an extra 6 weeks off during the year. And we allow our faculty structure it in 3-day blocks. So you work 3 overnights, you get 6 days off. Very similar to what emergency medicine physicians do. And in a lot of practices around the Southeast, at least, neuroradiologists also do that, because neurorads often take call to cover the CTAs or the stroke studies overnights as well. So something to keep in mind when you're choosing a subspecialty.
This may be a unique question, but we're talking about the publication list and publication, you know, research in prior either medical school or residency as a proven track of achievements and interest in a certain field. Is it ever, as an MD, PhD, I'm wondering, is it ever possible to oversell your passion and enthusiasm for research? Because let's face it, fellowship is a clinical duty-oriented program. You might get the one research day per week. Is it possible to negatively impact your application by saying, I'd like to do all this wonderful research? Thank you.
So at least at Duke, I'd probably say no. Again, we kind of weigh everything together. And so if you have a wonderful passion and you have a ton of publications, but during your interview it kind of falls flat, then we would say that's probably not a good fit regardless of your background. And so, at least again for us, like it certainly isn't going to hurt. But I think it probably is highly dependent on the program. So if you're looking at a place that maybe doesn't have the resources, or at least your interviewer perceives that they may not have the resources to kind of support your interests, then that may be an issue. I don't know.
Yeah, let me say that would be an issue. So if you have a practice that doesn't give you enough time to do that and people who aren't going to support it, then the question is, why would you ever apply to that place? Because you probably did your homework and discovered. But, you know, that all can come out in the interview. It's like, why aren't you going somewhere more academic if you're really the academic person? But if you have a very good reason, it would not be a disqualifier.
Yeah, no, we would love that.
Because you can do it during your Someone 6 days else. Off. Do it during 6 days off. Yeah.
So, if you are interested in two fields that are kind of related, let's say nukes and body and breast and body, and you want to do a six months of each, how to ask them, how in advance, or is that a possibility?
Yeah, right.
Start by saying, it depends on the program. You're talking about going to a program that doesn't normally offer that. So now we're getting into ACGME versus non-ACGME. Because you need a really flexible program that can basically build a fellowship around you. We have fielded fellowship applicants who come and say, I want to do 6 months of neuro and 6 months of ER. What that does is we basically fill an ER spot, and then we flex our fellows into elective time in neuroradiology, because otherwise our neuroradiology fellowship is ACGME and goes through the match. So we use an ER spot for that. If we already have four ER fellows, then you can't really take a neuro spot for that. There are other, obviously, hybrid fellowship programs in the country that you could try to target. Our body fellowship program is ACGME, so they would not have the flexibility to put you in 6 months of nukes, say.
Yeah, since breast is not an ACGME fellowship, but there is a match, you'd have to have an understanding. We've done it when there were two people internally who wanted to do breast and abdomen, so we just took two because we had that flexibility and had them do 6 months each. But, I mean, ACGME doesn't do that, so yeah. It depends.
Yeah, we actually offer a formal combined abdominal cardiothoracic fellowship. It typically fills internally, and it's typically people who know they're going into private practice rather than academics. Within our own cardiothoracic fellowship, again, it's a combination of pulmonary and cardiovascular. And the cardiovascular, we do all cardiovascular except for the neck and head. I mean, so we're doing the lower extremity runoffs, and some people don't like that. but that being said, we have had some fellows who want to kind of skew more towards the pulmonary or skew more towards the cardiovascular, and at least in our program, we offer that flexibility. It's not necessarily advertised, although I think on the website we have like a sentence that says something to the effect that that we can adjust kind of the proportions based upon your clinical and research interests. So, but I think it probably never hurts to reach out to a program director early on and just ask if there's a precedent for that in the past. But again, it would probably have to be a non-ACGME.
Non-ACGME. Thanks. And a reason for it.
Yeah.
I was a fellowship director, and we'd occasionally get requests like that, and the answer was always, just because. Like, if you want them to do something special for you, I would make sure you have, you know, a good, thought-out, valid reason of why they should do that.
Okay. You mentioned that fellowship is something that will follow you for a long time in your career. So in that regard, how important is it to target big names for fellowship? Do you think, is that really matter, or do you, like, versus smaller program or not well-known program?
Well, I guess I'll give you my opinion. So I do think it depends on what your career interests are. If your pretty sure you're going into academics, then I think the where you train is probably more important than if you're going into private practice. Although I will say, even in private practice, it opens doors, and sometimes it's a matter of like two equal candidates, but yet one came from a more renowned training program, and so I don't necessarily think it hurts. I also think it's important to remember that fellowship, I mean, it's generally just 1 year. I know some fellowships are longer, and I was kind of in the mindset, I mean, you can do anything for a year. My wife wasn't quite of that mindset, but that being said, it's always going to be a compromise, including your specialty that you go into. I mean, I'll tell you, I don't love inpatient films, and but yet I get to do a lot of other things that I find really interesting, and it kind of offsets that. and I think you're probably going to be hard-pressed to find a specialty that where you love everything about it. And when it comes to choosing a fellowship program, at least my approach has always been, and the advice I give our residents is, I mean, all things considered, it's probably best to go to a place where you feel it's going to be a good fit for you, and that means like where you want to live, what your spouse wants, kind of what you're hoping to get out of your fellowship, and then go to the best possible place that you can for your training, and you never know what the future holds. So.
Yeah, I mean, I would perhaps keep the reputation of the fellowship as one of a number of factors that you're considering. It probably is more important in academics if you want to have an academic career, but it really is only one of a number of factors. So I wouldn't weight it any higher than anything else.
Before we take another question, there's one other thing I want to comment on, and that's research. Not research in applying, but I actually thought I had no interest in research. I mean, I had done some research during residency. I'd done enough to the point where I knew I didn't want to write grants. There was always this kind of sense that if I go into academics, like you have to publish or perish, which is the old mantra. I will say I think academic medicine is evolving fairly rapidly. And I do still do research. I'm not a hardcore researcher. I know I have to do some research in order to stay on track for promotion, but personally, I'd much rather prepare a lecture than work on a paper. But it is a balance, and so I enjoy doing the clinical work. I enjoy teaching, and so that's why I chose to stay in academics. And along with that, I knew I'm going to have to do some research. But fortunately, I mean, I think everyone can find a niche. And so I've kind of found a niche in some technology-driven areas. Lung cancer screening happens to also be an area where I have interest. Again, I think everyone can find something. One of our current fellows, he actually already had a job in private practice, but during fellowship, he decided he actually really wants to do academics. And so we kind of worked with him on some projects during fellowship. And as it turns out, we actually offered him a job because we had an opening. And so he's going to be staying with us. But he's been very forward, like, I haven't done a lot of research in residency because I always thought I was going into private practice. He was worried whether or not Duke would be a good fit for him since he didn't have a strong research background. But again, he codes and he has a lot of other skill sets that we've been able to incorporate and get him involved in projects. I will say that as a resident, do not do a project unless you really have an interest as a general rule, and as a fellow as well. I tended to just say yes because I never wanted to miss an opportunity. But sometimes it was just pure drudgery getting through a project. And so find something where you really have a genuine interest and ask some questions around those topics and then try and identify a mentor who can help you develop that and move forward. So,
let me just take up on the academics the academic institutions are evolving, because you may have noticed around the country, it used to be there'd be a medical center and then all the smaller hospitals. But since Jared left Rochester, the University of Rochester has now, I think, 6 or 7 regional hospitals that feed centrally. So many times you can be a little of both. You're right. Doing some regional work, which is just like the old private practice, a little bit of driving included, but and then some central, you know, so some group, some, now I don't think, believe the fellows are ever going to be asked to drive. I think it has to be voluntary if they want, but I mean, in the job, ultimately, there's a nice mix. If somebody likes doing the security of being part of a bigger center and having mentors and people to send tricky cases to, but you might like to live a little more peripheral and do the regional work. So we now are hiring people for regional, but they're still part of the central group, so they have a little of both. That's, we also pay more for going regional, so there is that.
That's
too.
Actually my clinical job. So I work for Hopkins. I'm an employee of Johns Hopkins School of Medicine, but I'm in their community radiology division. So we work in DC, and we have a private practice model. So we don't have residents or fellows, but we're on the same system. So we actually dial in and go to their conferences, and so for me, it's the best of both worlds. So for jobs, there's a lot of change going on in the job market. One last question, yeah.
Hi, Sonia Barr from Dallas. First of all, it's actually a pleasure to be in the room with the future of radiology. One thing I wanted to throw in to consider is the potential future job market. So if you're torn between a couple of things and say you want an academic career, talk with your mentors or anybody who may have that knowledge. For example, cardiothoracic. Right now, you can get a job at any major academic medical center, and it turns out in private practice too, independent of who you are, just because you're in cardiothoracic, and we're not producing enough people to fill that void. So if you're torn between two things, and one is overcrowded, the other one isn't, and perhaps, you know, you want to have a jump start at a career, that would be one thing I'd add in addition to all the things that have been discussed.
I will say, I used to tell residents, though, don't pick a fellowship in something that you don't enjoy doing, because you will have to do it, even if you go into private practice, you know. So, but yeah. All right. Well, thank you so much to all of you for the questions, and thank you so much to our panel. Appreciate it. And if you all have any ideas for resident symposium topics that residents would be interested in outside of clinical stuff, please put it on your evaluations or just let me know. Thanks.